How you doing?
Good.
I almost died on the way out. So I should preface by saying that everywhere I go all over the world, you know, I play in Tokyo and LA and Montreal and Beijing and Bangalore and all these places. Everywhere I go, the number one question, have you ever played in Byfield, Massachusetts? Every time. And until a couple of years ago, I had to hang my head in shame and feel like not part of the in crowd. But now I hold my head high and say, yes. Well, it's great to be back. You guys are kind of almost Canadians here, so. So it feels very familiar. Oh, that's lots of reverb. Not really my thing. That's reasonable. All right. Here's the one and only blues tune I ever wrote. This is actually the 20th anniversary model. Mark and I started working together in 1997. So this is, this is like guitar number 10, I think, from Mark over the years. I have GAS, guitar acquirement syndrome. I'm kind of like walking billboard, touring billboard for Mark Beneteau. He makes amazing guitars. And so this one is kind of cool because he's made me a couple of guitars in this combo before. This is Spruce, I forget from where. It's either from Germany or Canada or Alaska. Sorry, Canada. And the back is made of cocobolo, which is an African wood that's related to rosewood. So it's very, very special. Sounds great, amazingly beautiful acoustically. But this one, as you may have noticed, has a fan fret system, which means each string is a little bit different length. There are reasons for doing that, mostly because I rarely tune to standard pitch, although I was for the song, standard tuning. But when you tune down, it makes for a nice high string tension still, so the strings still sound like something. Even way down, they're not going, they're actually get a note, right? It's just that when you tune to standard pitch, the tension's so high that your left forearm is going, oh dear God, about halfway through a tune in standard tuning. So I was halfway through that one realizing, oh right, I haven't really practiced on this guitar yet. Oh my God, that's what I was thinking about halfway through. Anyway, there you go. That was a tune of mine. It's a blues tune that I wrote in the home of the blues, Berlin, Germany. And for that reason, I named it after a bear because they put a bear on everything, you know, the coat of arms there. So the tune's called Blue Bear. Anyway, that makes no sense. If you have a request from one of my tunes this evening, feel free to shout it out. I know a lot of people Facebook me about this tour for some requests. And of course, I looked at them all and dutifully said, yes, I'd be happy to do that. Yes, of course, thank you for coming to my show. And just before the show, I was on my Facebook going, oh my God, which song was it? And which show was it? And what's their name? So if you had one of those, let me know.
Free Bird.
Michael. Free Bird, of course. That's, oh yeah, well that's a good one to continue with. Okay, sure. So they have a special table here for shy people that says reserved. It's pretty cool. So you guys are kind of shrinking violets here, right in the front row. So this next tune, I raised three kids, and my stepson, who died a few years ago, he, in the 90s, he was a teenager, and he was really into alternative rock, you know. You had to say rock with a special vowel sound, you know, alternative rock. And I couldn't help noticing that a lot of the songs he was listening to, because my office was right next to his bedroom, and you know, like when he closed the door, when he was listening to alternative rock, really all I could hear in the next room was and I realized it was the sound of the distortion pedal that every single Seattle band used. I think they all like, just kept borrowing the same one. They shared it amongst themselves. And so that was kind of interesting. And then, but I, you know, I'd hear some of the songs, and at dinner one night I'd say, hey Tash, that song you were listening, that band you were listening to, what were they called? Phlegm or Spit or something? Anyway, they're awesome. They sound like my old Black Sabbath records, you know. And he didn't understand what I was talking about then. The Osbournes hadn't had their own television show yet, so. Later in the same conversation, I mentioned that I had seen an old interview with Kurt Cobain from about 1990. Back when they used to play music on television, and you had MTV here in Canada, we had Much Music. So I saw this old interview with Kurt on Much Music, and I said, isn't it interesting that he felt in 1990 that parents and kids, there wasn't as much of a generation gap as there used to be? And it's true. I mean, like, I grew up with parents who grew up, like, they were born in, like, the 30s and stuff, and they were listening to opera and cowboy songs, you know, by Hank Snow and stuff like that, you know. It was a different world from growing up listening to records with pictures of ladies with green faces on them, right? So, in fact, my parents saw that album cover, the first Black Sabbath album. Just like, what the heck? You're darned to heck. Anyway, so I said, isn't it cool that in the dawn of the 90s, you know, Kurt kind of felt like parents and kids were listening to more or less the same music. And at that point, I could see him recoil in horror at the thought. So, you know, you're 14 years old. You want to have your own thing going on, right? Doesn't matter what your dad does for a living, he's still a square. So I couldn't help noticing he switched the next day exclusively to gangster rap. Okay, a little different. And at first I thought, well, I'm not hearing that anymore through the wall. What I'm hearing now is, and I thought, well, that's kind of cool. You know, that's this swing 16th rhythm. And I kind of thought, well, hey, it's a bit like, you know, Superstition by Stevie Wonder, perhaps. You know, there's a cognate there from my youth. I thought, okay, cool, I can borrow that. So I ended up writing what I think is the first solo hip-hop guitar tune ever written. I wrote it in 1995. It's a cool tune to whip out at the end of a set when I'm playing. I occasionally get asked to play, say, at a high school, like one of the three high schools in North America that still has a music program. You know, they'll actually have me come in and play for the kids very often. And before YouTube, you know, it was actually kind of rare for them to see somebody rocking out solo on a guitar. So inevitably, at the end of the set, I'd play this tune, and then there'd always be a gaggle of about, you know, three or four 13-year-old kids. Now I'm talking about Winnipeg, Manitoba here. You know, so they've got the backwards baseball cap, and they've got the baseball jacket, and they've got the chain to nowhere, and they've got the baggy trousers, and they talk with their hands and stuff like that, and they've got red hair and freckles, and their name is Rusty. And they come up to me and they say, yo, dude, like, you rock, dude. you were like freestyling. Sick. This is my buddy, man. He's like, whoa! And he's like, chaw. And you start doing slap harmonics and shit, and I'm like, whoa! And he's like, word. And we're like, oh man, you totally rock it, dude. And that feels really good. So, this is the tune they like. It's called Afraid to Dance. Thank you. Louis Armstrong towel up with me. I do a lot of my Louis Armstrong sweat imitation. So if anybody's got a towel back there or downstairs or whatever, you can bring up, that'd be awesome. Thank you. So I just finished a new CD. In fact, it's crazy. They wrote me from the factory yesterday and said, "Your CDs are ready, where should we send them?" And it's like, they were manufactured in Toronto, and Monday was a holiday in Toronto, in Ontario.
Thank you very much. So,
I was like, oh man, so if they hadn't had a holiday on Monday, I would have had CDs for this little tour. Because they're ready now, but they're not in my hands. So, anyway, the cool thing is that its official release is not until next month. But I did put it on this thing that I brought tonight. I have these USB sticks with everything I've ever recorded on them. My entire life's work in a little thing this big. No, it's a pen, actually. It's a functioning pen, a really nice pen. Thank you. And it has all 48,000 of my albums. I forget how many I've recorded at this point, but everything's on there from all the way back from the 80s. So kind of cool. And I put the new record on it, so that's one way to get it tonight. And the album's called A Million Brazilian Civilians. It's actually something I heard a reporter, a BBC reporter, say like last summer when all the unrest was happening in Brazil, and they were sort of all revolting to get rid of their president. This reporter actually said on the air, he said, "Millions of Brazilian civilians have gathered in the streets," and I thought, he's having us on. He's having a laugh. And that's a great album name. So there we go. This tune's on it. This is a cover of a very beautiful song. Very sad, beautiful song by a band called Biffy Clyro. They're a Scottish band. The original version is quite metal.
Chandelier, it's
heard the random F sharp of somebody getting an email on the phone. Hope it wasn't me.
You guys got the expensive show. lots of guitars.
So this is a baritone guitar, and it also has a fan fret system. This one's a little more obvious. just to explain the fan fret system, the whole idea is that not only do you get higher string tension, but also it seems to help the intonation a little bit. A tiny bit. Guitars are notoriously difficult in terms of playing in tune, but not as bad as ukuleles. And this song, this guitar, also made by Mark Beneteau, it sounds a fourth lower than a regular guitar, so four like alphabet letters. So like E is normally your lowest note. So this is a E, D, C, B, so it's a low B.
And
so normally this is your bottom string. That's the note you normally tune your bottom string to. But on this one, Danger, Will Robinson. Yeah, the string of Darth. Anyway, I'm going to play another tune from my PS15 record, which I see this wonderful person got on vinyl. Awesome. It's on see-through red vinyl, so you can bring it to bed. It's awesome. And this tune is the first tune I ever wrote for a baritone guitar back in the 90s. For whatever reason, I was inspired first to write something like it should have been the theme for a spy movie.
Thank you.
seahorse. Some people say it looks, you gotta mute that for a sec, Dave, sorry. Anyway, whatever you want to think it looks like, it looks pretty weird. It's not a new idea. It's an instrument that's been around for several centuries. And of course, before there were harp guitars, there were, I'm going to get the name wrong, the lute with extra bass strings on it. So the same idea. Anyway, it was just an attempt to extend the range of a regular instrument. And so this particular one was made by Mark Beneteau, my builder, but then it's based very much on a guitar that was very popular in the early part of the 20th century. It's made by the Dyer Harp Guitar Company. And it's actually made by the Larson Brothers under the name of Dyer Harp Guitars. They made guitars for Sears Roebuck and everybody else back then. So you have a regular guitar. Okay. Sounds awesome. And then you have all these bass strings. I first saw Michael Hedges play one of these back in the 80s and thought, that's cool, I think I know someone with one of those. So I went to this music store in downtown Toronto where I was living at the time. And sure enough, the guy, I was pretty sure it was the same instrument. He had it hanging in the window of the store, basically as advertising. And so I walked in and I said, hey Drago, does anybody ever play that guitar? And he says, no, none of us know how to play it. And I said, could I rent it? And he said, well, Don, I know who you are. Why don't you just go borrow it? So I borrowed it and gave it back eventually 3.5 years later. And he just kept never asking for it back. And I figured, you know, check it. He said, okay, yeah, sure. So I learned how to play the darn thing. And then eventually had to give it back because I felt badly holding onto it. And I couldn't afford to buy it. So then I didn't have one in my hands for like 25 years. And then I was in India, of all places, and I met a guy who made the exact replicas of those old Dyer Harp guitars. So anyway, about 2 years ago, I talked to Mark and I said, want to try making one? I brought this to the harp guitar gathering in Milford, Connecticut, not even all that far from here, back in October. And the guy who's the world expert on harp guitars, his name is Greg Miner, he lives in Southern California. He heard this guitar and he came up to me and he played it a little bit and he said, Don, let Mark know that I've seen them all, I've heard them all, and I've played them all. And that's the best sounding harp guitar I've ever heard. And yeah, and it's the first one Mark ever made, so he hit it out of the park in the first try. So, just for a larf, I'll play you something that's on the Million Brazilian Civilian albums, Civilians album. And this is actually an arrangement of an old soul tune, a Philadelphia soul tune, written by Tom Bell and Linda Creed. You may know it as a big hit for the Stylistics in 1971, and has the unlikely title, Betcha by Golly Wow. I gotta take these off to think. I can't, I'm nearsighted, so I go to look at it and go, too many strings. Let me try that again. It's all wrong. Here we go. Thank you.
always a little bit, ah. But it's good for you, right? It's good for you. It keeps you young or keeps you stupid or something. Having a good time?
Yeah.
Well, that is why we're all here, after all.
Lovely.
Don't ever stop coming. All right. Like I say, you know, it's done wonders for my reputation playing black.
Are you having a good time?
Absolutely. I have the best time ever in black. I tell people about how much fun this gig is. In places like Bangalore, as in, and they want to know. No, whenever Dave writes me and says, you want to come back? I just say, when? You guys are awesome. Here's another tune from the Million Brazilian Civilians record. Always have to think about it. I'm trying to get the title right. And it's another tune for the baritone guitar. I first wrote this back in the early 2000s, and my older daughter Tara is here tonight. She helped me. She flew down from Montreal and helped me schlep gear on this tour, and she's selling merch at the back of the room. So I get to meet the younger female clone of Tara. And her sister Maya, when she first heard this tune, Maya was all 8 years old or something when I wrote it. And she said, Dad, I really like that funky new tune you wrote. And I said, well, thank you very much. She said, I was thinking you should name it after a movie monster. And I said, sure, sounds like my kid would say something like that. Which movie monster? She said, I was thinking like Dracula. And I said, okay, sure, I can call it Dracula. She said, no. Then I was thinking some more about this whole thing. And I thought, what if Dracula had his own Saturday morning cartoon show? And I said, this is very intriguing. What would the show be called, Maya? You have to imagine an 8-year-old in a sundress, you know, with hands on hips. Dracula and Friends. So this tune is called Dracula and Friends Part 2. Thank you. Well, earlier on, I heard a request for part of this next medley of tunes. So this next little pair of tunes we're going to end this set with, and be sure to talk to Tara at the back of the room about LP or CD or the USB pin or, there's even a t-shirt now. Very cool t-shirt, yeah. Tuning from the ninth room of Saturn, I'm sure the last one. So the first part of this medley was a massive radio hit for somebody else. And it's a song that actually I sort of boycotted for about a year. The guy who sang it and the band put it together back in about 2006. Started tweet bragging about terrible things that he had done, and I thought, well, screw that, I'm not doing a song anymore. And then after I got over the kind of knee-jerk reaction, about a year later, I realized that I both enjoy and play a lot of music by people who did objectionable things. And I mean, let's face it, right? I mean, Miles Davis is a wife beater, right? And Elvis liked 14-year-olds, and you know, it's all kinds of things that everybody knows about these people who are, you know, deified now. And so I thought, okay, then there's the artist and there's the art. Okay, you can enjoy the art. Leonardo was a weirdo. Michelangelo was a weirdo. You can enjoy the art and not worry too much about the artist. Just enjoy the art for its own sake. It's a good thing. So, that I kind of got over my knee-jerk and started playing the song again. And the second half of this is a tune I wrote dedicated to the late, great Michael Hedges, who was somebody who inspired a lot of us to do this crazy thing for a living. And also blazed the trail for sort of modern, you know, music to enter into the whole sort of fingerstyle guitar world and getting beyond the kind of, you know, Travis picking thing that had been dominant for 20 or 30 years before that. So kind of cool. So originally I wrote the second part of this tune. It was supposed to be a duet for Michael and me to play together. I got to know Michael back in the 80s, and we'd get together whenever he was in Toronto where I was living at the time. And so finally I said, would you be interested in recording something with me? And he said, absolutely, it would be fun. So I wrote a tune. Actually, I've already played it. I played Afraid to Dance. That was the tune I originally wrote, that sort of hip-hoppy tune. That was supposed to be a duet for me and Michael. But when I sent him a cassette, and back in the day, and it was that version of the tune, basically. And he said, Don, he says, that I love the tune. Nothing wrong with the tune. I just have no idea what I would do on it. You kind of covered all the bases. And I went, yeah, okay, fair enough. All right. So I'll write something else. I'll leave some room for you. And so over the course of about the next year, I worked on this next, the second half of this next tune. And I finally felt, okay, it's finished, and there's room for Michael to do something. And 2 days later, I found out Michael had died in a car accident. And I was like, oh man, this is ridiculous, that's terrible. So I was shocked but not surprised. He was a terrible driver, let's just put it that way. So that he died that way is, you know, tragic, but not surprising. So I thought, well, what can I do? So I decided to flesh it out and turn it into a solo tune, fill in all the cracks, and dedicate it to him. So the day I found out he was gone, I was just I was on the road. I was in the west coast of Canada in this town called Nanaimo, British Columbia, and I was like beside myself with grief, and I was just going, Michael, Michael, Michael. Oh, I could call the tune, Michael, Michael, Michael. I was just muttering his name over and over again. So the first half of this is Crazy by Gnarls Barkley, and the second half is Michael, 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 and I'll see you in a few minutes after this one. Thank you. Thank you very much. See you in a few minutes.